Thank you. Thanks a lot. I have the difficult task of talking about the costs of AMR. So just a starting statement, like all costing analysis, including this one, and don't kill me, Rebecca, you and I have had a long conversation on this one. All costing analysis are fraught with trouble because they're based on a number of assumptions. So we have to be very conscious of that. Having said that, if we can narrow down the range or the kind of variability of the estimates, then I think we are kind of closer to a point of reality and therefore closer to consensus. So I will spend a little bit of time on the work that we have done at the bank. I'll try to focus a little bit on the methodology and then try to give some results, which I think are also pretty important. The work that I shall be speaking about just now draws from two pieces, one in 2016 that was led by Olga Jonas, and that had a team of maybe 555 people. And the second one, which is a forthcoming piece, that is my colleagues from DEC and elsewhere, and that is forthcoming, I think, sometime by end of this year in the World Development. So still embargo. So please do take notes if you want to, but we will not be able to give out a copy of this. At least that's what I've been told by the authors. So the way that we think about this is, and you heard a flavor of that earlier on in the morning when Anas was speaking about this, is that you look at the main economic impacts of AMR, and you look at the different channels through which the impacts can be felt, and we distinguish the following channels. One is through human morbidity, which therefore reduces labor supply. The other is to human mortality, because people are not there anymore, so therefore labor supply falls down. Morbidity, and that therefore leads to a fall in productivity. Increase in livestock mortality and morbidity, which then leads to a decline in livestock production that increases the price of some proteins. And then there's a fear factor, and we heard Peter Sands speak about it this morning, and others also alluded to it, that leads to border restrictions, that leads to all sorts of issues to do with trade and transport margins, and global trade falls. So we try to estimate all of these costs. It's not an easy exercise, as you can imagine. So the total cost, so the methodology that we use is actually pretty straightforward. First, you split up the costs into what we call the direct costs and what are the indirect costs. So the direct costs are simply those, which is the money that you use to treat people who fall ill. So that's the simple one. It's just the healthcare expenditure. And the indirect costs are all of the others that we spoke about earlier, which is present and future costs to society because of loss of output. Remember, there's fall in labor supply, fall in productivity. If my production function has labor in it, which then matters, then therefore there will be a fall in the output. So you have to capture that. Disruption in exports due to the fear factor, and we spoke about that earlier. And in the livestock sector, a same kind of analysis. So very simple, very, very straightforward so far. And you calculate the costs by first you assume a world without AMR, and then you project your costs over a time period, or your growth, or your economic variables over a time period. Then you assume some different levels of AMR. Again, compute the same variables. Whatever the delta is, that's the cost. That's very, very simple. The methodology here is straightforward. It's completely logical. It's very, very easy to do all of this. Think of the world in terms of four different economic groups, which is what we do at the bank, and in terms of low income, lower middle income, higher middle income, and high income, and figure out a way in which you can think of different levels of AMR severity. You have low case, middle case, and high case, and you will see that these numbers are closely linked with the RAND study, which was done by Taylor et al., and where they had SC1, or rather SC0 all the way to SC10. So these numbers are drawn from that, and then you simply calculate the cost difference. Some results, and if you want more details about the methodology, happy to go into that. The real GDP, so the top line that you see, that is the base case. So the base case is no AMR. Everything is okay. We never heard about AMR. This is how we have now normalized it over the next 30, 40 years, and that is the straight line. Everything else that you see and you simply look at the delta, then that is the additional cost. And if you look at the additional cost, then that is the number that you see that the GDP is going to fall by so much of a percent. Same thing you see in the case of exports. Now you would wonder why this line first falls and then straightens out. This straightens out because people adjust. Economies adjust to the new circumstances. The factors of production then change and people adjust, behavior adjusts. Economic behavior at the macro level can be better predicted than economic behavior at the micro level. So that then adjusts, and which is why you see a dip and then you see everything flatter after the first initial shock is over, assuming that it takes that much time for the system to adjust. Same thing for livestock exports. This kind of calculation was quite difficult, particularly for livestock exports, because we have very, very little data on this. Practically no study. Indeed, the only study that we could find that we referred to was the one, the 2015, the OECD study, which was led by Ramanan and others. I think it was OECD paper was 76 or some such. That is the only one that we found and the only one that we have used for this particular analysis. The extra health expenditure was again calculated. For this, we used the study, we drew inspiration from the study, which was done by KPMG. I think it's the 2014 study of KPMG that we then brought up to using our own estimates. The way that we have worked all of this is using a CGE model, using a dynamic CGE model, which has not been done before. The previous modeling that has been done, it has been done on comparative static models, and we have used a dynamic model. That is one difference. Second difference is that we have used something called the Globe DYN database that is extremely rich in numbers, that gives us structural values, which were not there in the previous studies, which I'm speaking about, particularly those studies which are used by and Taylor et al. And so on. But so this one gives you a much richer data set and then gives you this kind of information. We then sum it up because the economic cost is simply the sum of all of these costs. And what this table does is summarizes all of the results, all of the modeling that has gone into this, all with all of the assumptions. So remember, what we are trying to do here is to compare the baseline which we are trying to project over the next 30, 40 years. Now you can imagine how difficult that is to start with. And then using each and every other economic variable on the same assumptions, on the same trajectory, but with the only difference being that now we are factoring in the economic impacts due to either morbidity or mortality or livestock or fear or exports and so on. So this is the scenario that it comes to, and we calculate the present value at different discount rates. We don't know which one we should be using. You have seen the 3.5% is the one that we find most oftentimes used. So let me figure out or speak about those numbers only. If it is a high case scenario, it is 53.7 trillion. These numbers are in trillion dollars at 2007 prices. So 2007 prices, $53.7 trillion is going to be the loss in GDP alone. Add to that a further $14.3 trillion due to exports and increase a further $11 trillion due to high costs. So when you add up all of these, you are roughly in the range of 80 to 90 trillion. How does this compare to other studies? Well, it's much, much more than all the previous studies that we have seen by a factor of maybe 20. The ones that we have seen earlier are in the range of 1 to 5 trillion. our numbers show and actually bring us to a level which is significantly higher. But when I say significantly higher, it is still between 3 to 4% of GDP, which if it is just AMR alone, is extremely high. Add to this then all the other perils, add to this the pandemics, and we heard about that in the previous sessions. And if these are the kind of things which we are not able to control for, this, we believe, is well within the realms of control, perhaps. And so then you can imagine that we are losing 10 cents to a dollar just because we are not able to or not willing to act fast enough and hard enough. Thank you.